call to order the Sunderland School Committee meeting for Tuesday, December 20th, 2016. First on the agenda tonight is review the minutes from November meeting. Any discussion? Motions before discussion? Except I'll, entertain motions to approve minutes from the November meeting. If anybody wants to make that?
I'll make a motion to approve the minutes.
All right.
From the November meeting.
I'll second.
All right. Any discussion?
I'll do the main.
All right. All in favor? Aye.
I wasn't here last one.
You can. You can abstain, you can actually vote. You don't have to have been there, my understanding, to vote in favor of you.
Right, I'm agreeing with them.
So
take my word for it.
Unanimous. All right, thanks. Then financial statements.
Okay, so tonight you have 7 warrants to sign totaling $87,676.66. We also have some payroll warrants for you to sign so that we can continue processing payroll. So make sure you sign each of the sheets, and I need 3 signatures minimum. The reports that I emailed you now have our salaries encumbered, so it tells us where we are, and I'm not having any major concerns. The principal, Ben Barshevsky, and I have been working to reclass some things because it seems that everything hit one account. We don't know out what end that error was on, but we're working to reclassify some expenditures to where they properly belong. I do want to tell you that we had an issue with the town about our prior year encumbrances. A clerical error was made, and we're short some money of paying our bills. So I'm working with Sherry Patch, the town administrator, to get that rectified, but we may need to spend about $5,000 from this year, and hopefully the town will give it back to us at the annual town meeting. So I'm continuing to work closely with them to get this resolved, and hopefully we'll have a good outcome. And that's all I have, unless you have any questions.
So this isn't one where it was classified, or was it something that was initially classified different, or like in a different place?
Well,
and then
what happened was, so when we encumber in June, mm-hmm. they really want to see us get those bills paid in September. Mm-hmm. And what happened was we had encumbered, if you remember correctly, this goes back to the end of June of 15. Mm-hmm. That prior winter, we had a lot of damage to the lower end of the building. Mm-hmm. And so we, in the summer, had some money. At the end of the year, we had some money. So we contracted to have the foundation and the siding repaired.
Yep.
When we went to get this project done, we couldn't locate matching siding. When we finally located the matching siding, it was too cold to fix the foundation. So the project got pushed off till spring. The gentleman that we use, as talented as he is a sole proprietor, and he's really slow to bill. So in June of 16, I still hadn't gotten the bill to pay the FY15 encumbrance. Somehow, the encumbrance got closed out. There's the error. But when we did get our hands on the bill, we processed it, and the town paid it against our FY16 encumbrances. So now there's not enough money left to pay the things that we encumbered in FY16. So it was sort of like a perfect storm of just things rolling down the hill.
Okay. So the town is
they're okay working with me to come up with a way to resolve this.
They're not going to come to our budget meeting in March and say,
I don't know what they're going to do, Doc.
You guys are going to 5,000. Well,
they could.
We'll find out.
Well, yeah.
Maybe I'll talk to them in advance.
Yeah. Well, I think Sherry was supposed to meet with them Monday night. I just haven't gotten a chance to talk to her because she was out sick and she missed a couple of meetings. So, and I can check with her. I will make a note to call her tomorrow and see where we are. And if I get an answer, I will shoot you guys out an email.
Anybody, the ballpark of 5,000, you said?
You said one account got hit particularly hard. Which one was that?
It was the general supplies account, and the error was, for example, we have a SPED testing line item, and instead of taking a SPED test protocols out of that line item, it was taken out of general supplies.
So there's just some confusion between, and this is a very fine line, between what's a general supply and what's an instructional material and supply. So
if you hold it this way, it's one thing. If you hold it that way, it's another.
Exactly. So we overuse one account and underuse the other. So we're trying to match them where they truly belong.
Ask one more question?
Yes.
I just look for big numbers. Can I ask about, I think we approved this one actually, the salaries for IA SPED. Page 8. It's like over or negative 51%, $71,241.
Okay.
Is that?
It could be the encumbrance. I'll have to look at that. But I know that we did end up having to hire someone since we did this budget. So,
right.
So that could, but that shouldn't be $71,000.
I didn't know if that was, if we had approved the, the early childhood.
That, no, that, that was, this is not the early childhood teacher.
Okay. Right.
But I will look into that.
Okay. Thank you. That's the only, is that my last question?
Great. Any others? That's good.
All right.
Is that it?
Yep.
Okay. Thanks. Public comment. No comments? All right, moving on. So unfinished business. We have the FY18 budget calendar to discuss and vote. So, do you want to talk to it at all?
We're looking at the date. So but what I wanted to do is look at it. The reason why we didn't hand it out last time was because Patty wasn't here. Mm-hmm. However, if we want to go over it, do we feel like we have enough meetings? Do we want to meet?
So the consideration that I had, so this is just a there's folks watching at home, was a begin the deliberations at the January meeting, mm-hmm. continue that February, present to the select board and finance committee somewhere in the late February, early March timeframe, and then have the public hearing and kind of final deliberations and vote a budget at the March meeting, and then town meeting in April. You know, the what I raised a bit in the last meeting and haven't sorted out in the meantime was, is there a way to get the public hearing in before that March meeting where we get, where we're really going right on the heels of that trying to vote the budget, as opposed to, you know, if there's something significant in the public hearing that we feel like we want to try to accommodate, it's probably going to be hard to do and sort it out in that meeting, potentially. So, and yet, if we don't in that meeting, it sets us up to probably to have a special meeting in order to get the budget done in time to be able to warrant the warrant for the town meeting, blah, 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 blah. So, I mean, we could punt on that piece of it. I mean, vote it provisionally, the calendar, with a goal of seeing if there's a way to have a public hearing in advance of
the Would you want that before we go to the town select board and the finance committee?
I think it's not not a bad idea. You know, there's arguments both ways. I mean, we know, obviously, we know more what the select board is looking for after we've met with them, but we have input from the public potentially when we go to the select board in terms of like, this is what we're hearing, this is why, we get people reaching out to us, obviously, outside of public hearings, but thoughts, anybody else? Is this just my...
It makes sense.
My... be in the bonnet, or...
Well, sometimes I think, in good faith, the more we can explain, the more we can show, the more we can talk about it, the more comfortable people are.
Mm-hmm. I think that's the thing. I think from a, in some years, it doesn't matter. But in other years, I think, I've seen where folks felt like that it was, the input, wasn't as meaningful as it could be, given that we're going to go right on the heels of that.
One of the things that we really need to help the community understand, to help us all understand, unlike the other union schools, Sunderland is growing. And it's growing in many ways. We have more children, but we also have more needs. We also have, what I heard is 22 to 23 English learners in our school. And that presents its own. The support needed, the demographics in Sunderland are such that a lot of our students coming in need support. Mm-hmm. It's the demographics. And we need to help everyone understand that we are growing and there's something on the books for another development somewhere in Sunderland. And we to keep an eye towards the future, we are growing. But we're not only just growing in numbers, we're growing in needs. We are having children that are coming with a variety of needs.
That costs money.
And it does, but it also makes us a stronger community. And the diversity is fantastic. Today was just a wonderful example. Today was phenomenal with the concert. It was great. I just had a blast. It was so good. So I think if we're out there and we're talking and we're sharing this information, and we can't really get into too many details, but I think anyone who knows the community or who wants us to succeed, they need to know. That we do have more students, we do have more needs.
Patty, do you think it would be realistic that we would be far enough along in the February to do the public hearing and have deliberations? Should we try to have a public hearing that's separate from our meeting schedule, or?
Well, we don't normally split the town meeting, the public hearing from the meeting. But we could sneak in another meeting if need be. So if we have the public hearing and we have our meeting, mm-hmm. and you're not comfortable taking a vote,
right.
we table that and then we schedule another meeting.
Well, and we have, so if we did it in February, we would have, unless you think that we're not going to be far enough along.
No, that's what I think. If anything, we add a meeting in March.
Okay. I mean,
Doug, and this is going to be my fourth time that we're doing the hearings. Nobody comes. So I'm more concerned about us going to the select board and having to redo than I am the town, the public hearing.
So it's most times nobody comes. In the times when people do come, I think there's been dissatisfaction with the fact that the timing of when it happens in the process. So you're being asked input in the 24th hour.
No, but when we're deliberating, they could come. They can come on the 17th. They can come on the 14th.
Right.
That's when we should be getting the input. And when we go to the town meeting, we're saying we're done. That's what the public hearing's for. We're done.
So we could try to build that in and really promote it in the in what we do to the community.
Right.
That you know, as at least as much as that public hearing, that, you know, don't just think of public hearing as your only opportunity to weigh in on this. Promote it through the PTO and other avenues in the town. Maybe even, you know, I don't know, a robocall makes sense or whatever, but to let people know, you know, the school budget is going to start in January and continue in February and right through the March meeting, and have, let your voice be heard and come to the meetings, and we will give time, you know, in the public comment section to really.
And I think that would be more productive in the February 14th meeting, so that when we have the March 21st meeting, we're ready to go. And we've had our, you know, I mean, the public hearing is just, you know, it's called a public hearing, but that's not the time to give the input, which is weird. I get it, you know.
So then I think, and then I think I'll just need to, you know, not be, you know, I need to keep our meetings on track, but at the same time, like, if we're go into that budget deliberations, to be able to allow to get some input, not necessarily have a full on so public debate, but
so yeah. For that input, Patty, is what you're saying that it makes more sense for folks to start coming to the February meeting, mm-hmm, than the January meeting?
Mm-hmm. Well, the January meeting we're going to present and we're going to discuss.
Right.
So then, after the school committee has seen it for the first time, yeah, and they've digested it, then we can, you know, let it out to the, you know, it's then a public document, and then let the, you know, people start giving some feedback. Come to the February meeting, make your comments, you know, give us your input, give us your feedback, and then we have time to readjust and then be ready to go in March. And then if March isn't successful, then we've got a couple of weeks before we've really got to get, you know, we've got to get that over to the town.
Then we could have at that point, have a special meeting, but I think that gives us a better opportunity of not feeling that way. And I know I've been on the committee where I felt like, and maybe we even did wind up having another meeting because it was just clearly going to be problematic not to. So,
And we've got another week in March. So, like, if we had our meeting March 21st, it's a Tuesday, I mean, we've got the entire next week, the 27th through the 31st, that we could build in a meeting.
And I don't know when the select board needs to have it to get it on the warrant, but I think that leaves time. But and probably that won't happen, especially I think if we do this, maybe this.
I also think maybe we consider a meeting early March, in between that February and the final public hearing. Because I think the public hearing for the school committee meetings, I think, is the avenue that people are supposed to come out and give their feedback. And Frontier is doing the same thing. They've added a possible second meeting or additional meeting. And I think the whole idea is just to be wide open, transparent, and just take all voices. But once that 21st, I think that public hearing is just a formalized final, here's what we've finished.
Yeah.
So if we roll it out in January, and I think maybe, like, I don't know if the principal's message, just on the website or, you know,
do a robocall,
something like that, if people are concerned about the budget and they want their voice, you know, January will be rolled out. They can also look at it February, and we can have public comment, that'd be fine. And then if things really need some work, I would be open to having something in the beginning of March, have an additional quasi-public hearing at that point, and then we're still online to hit the March 21st.
We just have to be careful, because the beginning of March is, we've got four other school committee meetings, so that our time is limited there. That's why the last week is always the open week to have the meeting.
You can't get a half dozen done at the beginning of March.
Hmm?
You can't get a half dozen meetings done at the beginning of March.
Well, I'm also wondering, do we want to have an extra meeting before we go to the selectmen, or after we go to the selectmen, the town finance? And I'm asking you because I don't have that history here. What works better? Do we hear from them, or do we hear from the community first and then bring that to the selectmen and the town finance?
I think the last option. It's more, I think it's best to really know, have a solid commitment to our plan when you go in front of the selectmen.
So that would mean
from the public and us.
Yeah, the extra meeting would take place at the end of February after vacation, And then the following week, or week after, we would present to the select board. So first week of March, second week of March.
Last year, if I remember correctly, the town called us to go to their meeting before we even presented here, remember, Doug?
Mm-hmm.
So we had to have a mini meeting so that you guys could see the budget before we had to go see them. They call us early in January. That's the problem. So they're going to have to, I'm trying to see if I can roll back and see what the date was. For some reason, and I don't know why, I had us that, and I don't remember this, maybe one of you guys will, I had that we had a meeting, oh, no, that was just us, okay, wait a minute. I can't find the paper, I cannot find the date.
Well, should we do this? Could we try to, by the January meeting, we could talk with the select board, find out when they were thinking about having us come in, if they had that. And then, I mean, sometimes they just want to see it early, you know, they might just want to see that draft and even talk with you guys before, or a little bit before we all meet with them, just because they're just trying to get ballpark ideas, right, in terms of what the budget's shaping up to look like overall for the town.
And haven't we invited them before to like the February?
And we have had them, like, and they've come. Yeah,
I think that's last useful. Year. Yeah,
absolutely. So, and then by that January meeting, figure out when we want to have the public hearing and the select board meeting. And I'll get on that before January 17th. What do you think?
Yeah, I don't have it in my calendar.
I just need that. Iron out the details. So at the, we are going to invite the select board.
They might want to come to the January meeting, mm-hmm. and or the February.
Who invites them? Do we invite them?
It's nice to have it. Semi-formally.
So the selectmen and the finance committee.
Yeah. And really just like bringing to their attention that it's happening, we'd love to have them join. But in between now and January, find out a little bit more about what they're thinking in terms of their schedule and when they are trying to have us come in to their meeting.
My feeling is that I would vote for the schedule with an addendum that we may add a meeting between the February and March, if needed.
Yeah. I like that.
Circling around.
Yeah.
Whenever would be workable.
If the calendar is a fluid document, so
yeah,
we're just accepting it as is, knowing that it can be amended at any time.
Okay.
All right, is that a motion?
Make a motion that we accept the document as presented. Knowing that it's a fluid document, we make a good change at any time.
All right, all in favor?
Okay, so I'm sorry, I know Keith was the first who seconded it.
Michelle. Yep.
And then, are you going to reach out to select and finance,
yes,
or just to send along an invitation?
I will.
Oh yeah, you'll
I'll
invite them.
Your attention.
Yep, yep,
yeah,
yep.
John Hathaway.
Great.
Thank you.
Great.
Super.
So, next. So new business, long-range facilities plan. Guess that's why we've got you here.
What Lynn has asked me to do is to get a facility plan for all of the schools in the district that is similar and serves a need for some long-range planning. I had a document that I used in the high school for a couple of years. It worked pretty good. And I've expanded that this year. I had project lists for all of the schools, but I didn't have anything that I would have been comfortable bringing up and presenting. So I tried to put all of the schools on the same format with some projects and prioritization, and then a small group of projects that I see as important projects that I took the time to price up. I stayed away from the term long-range capital planning because the true definition for capital projects is very, very big projects. And the bulk of the projects that I find that really need to be done in the schools that are hard to deal with are kind of mid-range projects. They're larger projects than you'd want to have in the every year operating budget, but they don't rise to the level of a capital project. I used to work somewhere where we had a budget we called replacement renewal, and it was something that we funded and kept a balance on and approved projects out of every year. Some of the towns, I'm not sure about Sunderland, have a fund that they're starting to do that with, but it works really good for these kinds of projects.
Yep. The select board has definitely been pushing that for years to that kind of money.
What I've done here is the first document that I handed out just lists projects in a relative range of priorities. The ones in red are things that I think should be done relatively quickly. The things in yellow are projects that ought to be really seriously thought about in the next couple of years. And then the ones in black in the last column are bigger projects that are looming out there that we need to start thinking about. This is not a precise document. I've got a few numbers on some of these projects that are things that I've done. But trying to get really good pricing on this many projects, multiplied times four other schools, is an impossible task. And putting numbers next to a project on a very rough estimate is a very dangerous thing in my mind, because numbers very quickly take a life of their own. So I stayed away on this. I can answer questions if you have them about what I think the relative order of magnitude is. And one thing that I did do is that projects that were immediate needs, I tried to get the best estimate that I could for those. Those projects are projects I'd love to see done in the next year. I'm not kidding myself that I have no idea whether they'll be funded or not. This document, from my perspective, is a place to start discussion. I welcome any input from any of you as to the format or the projects that are on the list. I did meet with Ben and David, the day custodian here, and went over things that they saw as issues and projects and priorities. So I think I've captured a good percentage of what needs to be done, but I even found myself on the way over here tonight thinking, I'm gonna write this down so the next time I present it, I'll add that to the project list too. So if you'd like to ask any questions about the bigger list, or if you'd like me to go individually, and I can tell you something about that list of projects that I see as a priority. I can run down that list and tell you what I see, how I define what's in there and what I see that project to be.
For example, in that five plus, but those are, some of them are bigger things. Is there anything in that black third column that you feel like is a potential pain point, if it doesn't get addressed?
We've off and on had some problems with the boilers and heating system, in this building, we've had, in the time I've been here, we've had a couple of cracked boilers that had to be replaced. The boilers that you have here are a style of boiler that tends to last for a long time. I'm surprised you've had the problems you've had. Many people keep these types of boilers a lot longer than they should. Mm-hmm. They're getting to be old technology. They're not terribly efficient. You know, that's a project that, you know, something could happen and it could become more of a priority. But also, I would love to see it ratcheted up a little bit too, because I think it's good for the school. It'll give them a more dependable system, but it's also going to save some energy. Looking at some of the ones that are farther out here. Well, when I come to this school and look around, especially in the boiler room, I see some issues in the piping that I don't quite understand. And something that I'd like to have done here eventually is to have someone come in and do some testing. I think there may be an issue with electrolysis in the water or grounding in the electrical to the piping system or something. But I see some corrosion in the boiler plant. That it's not a huge thing. It's not going to be a problem overnight. But in the long term, I see the infrastructure of this building, in my opinion, aging a little faster than it should. And also, one of the shorter term projects I have on here is some more work on the siding. The building here has vinyl siding on it, which if I was to choose a finish for a school building, it wouldn't be my first choice. You know, most of our other schools are brick and masonry and that sort of thing, and they tend to hold up and look a little better for a longer time. So it's something that's going to be an ongoing issue for this school. The worst, you know, we did have some serious problems with what Patty was alluding to earlier, where we actually had some rot that could have been structural, but turned out wasn't. There was some 2x10s in there that were mostly put in there to hold the siding, and the siding wasn't applied in a good way around them, and water got under there and rotted it. We got that cleaned up and taken care of. But if you walk around and look at the outside of the building, it tends to look a little old and really needs some cleaning up. And there's a good amount of the siding that, through temperature changes and that sort of stuff, has cracked. And so I would say the building exterior is a little needy.
The boiler, I think, I feel like that was one that we got, because the select board was collecting potential capital projects to think about for, you know, with the capital fund building and with kind of projects like that in mind. And I think that was one
that's been identified.
Yeah.
A little more short term than the boiler, the hot water heater in this building is, you know, when this building was built, for some reason, well, they designed it with locker rooms, and it never really got used. And there's a hot water heater in the building that's immensely oversized for the load and currently in the building.
Right.
And that's when I've got more in the mid-range projects, because it's very inefficient from my perspective. But yeah, it's not a cheap replacement. Because it's going to be expensive just to throw the old one away. So but it's a project that needs to be done.
Is it not like it's Sears, nice, where they take the old one away and let it fix the new one?
So, you know, hopefully we'll maintain this document, and from year to year we'll knock off some of the projects, and we'll be able to say when we go back for funding next year and the year after, but we've been asking for this.
Questions? Comments?
Question. Says window replacement, kind of long term, like specific windows or just in
general? Well, again, the windows in this building are a wood framed window. Some of them, I believe, were replaced when they had the issues with the roof. One area of windows were replaced, but there's a good percentage of the windows in the building that have hardware issues and functionality issues, and they're not tremendously efficient. So I think probably a good way to work this building would be to incrementally talk with Ben and his teachers and find areas that have been especially problematic and put together a project where we do another quarter of the building. And that's one of the things that I really look to you folks for, is a little bit of direction in things that you see as good projects and you would like me to spend some time. You know, I'm hesitant to price up, I'm more than hesitant, I don't want to price up this whole list, but if there are things on here that you're very supportive of, you've heard from Ben or other people in the community that are issues, and you'd really like a better number on, if you tell me to focus on those things, I will.
Okay, just got two more questions. What is plastic urethane for the gym floor?
The floor in your gym is an unusual floor.
Yeah.
And, you know, we've had some issues over the years with it being slippery.
Yeah.
And it's just not, you know, all the other schools have a wood floor.
So, is this saying, would it be replacing the same thing that it is, or going to?
Well, that's a good question. I mean, my first proposal would be to put a more conventional floor in there, to put a wood floor in there. I'm sure there must have been some discussion in the community at the time it went in. I don't see a lot of those floors anywhere. So I'm guessing it was something that probably was popular when the school was built. People were selling them and saying they're low maintenance, they're better than wood, they're this, they're that. But I don't see that they've caught on, and I don't see a lot of those floors.
When was the school built?
The building here was built in the mid-90s.
Yeah. And I think for the gym floor, one of the reasons that surface was put down is that because it is a town facility to be used for other events like town meetings and, well, I guess voting as well, and bringing a lot of chairs, dragging those across.
And voting machine,
dragging those across a wood floor with a finish on top would scratch the floor pretty significantly. So that might be why, though.
So, all I know is the last time there were issues with the floor being slippery, I bought the manufacturer out here and we talked about it. And he basically said the floor was in good shape. He gave us some recommendations for care and maintenance that I think we've been able to improve that some, but he said the floor's got another 5 or 6 years of life in it. And so I'm just carrying that number as something that, or that project as something that we're gonna have to replace that floor eventually. And I'm sure we're gonna have to have a debate about whether we put another similar floor in or more conventional.
And then maybe this one might be more fan, but you mentioned like good projects. I see like a lot of little library projects.
Mm-hmm.
Would like one larger library project maybe more fit the bill if you could have your way?
I think the air conditioning for the library would definitely be a priority now, because it heats up so much in there during the fall and the spring months, and being able to take care of the technology so that it doesn't get too hot.
Yep.
And burn them out, that would definitely be a priority. Some of this, I went to the faculty and staff here at Sunderland also, because it's impossible for Bob and I to know every nook and cranny in the building, what needs work. So a lot of this is based on feedback from the staff as well. And they're able to identify what windows need fixed, which ones don't open, which don't close, and have to close manually from the outside. So that's where we got some of these.
And my guess on the library, if we did it with a ductless mini split, it wasn't a big area on the system that cooled the space, we probably talked $8,000 to $12,000
So January 9th, capital requests are due to the town. Mr. Fulton is the senior member. Do we have a capital, like a savings account going with the town?
I'm not certain.
I'm pretty sure there is.
No.
And that the town has one.
So is there any requests we want to put in? Right. Because we won't see you before they're due again.
They're due?
January 9th.
I do need to plug one of the priority projects. It's not a funds, not a fun one, but the very first one on there that talks about replacing the steamer kettle boiler. We had three kitchens with those in them that were all put in approximately the same vintage. The one in Deerfield failed last summer, and the one in Frontier failed 2 months ago. And yours here is identical. So I'm guessing, unless you guys beat the law of averages, that one's going to die in the next year or so.
Okay. And that's, so in those cases, it's something, it's essential equipment in the kitchen, right? So it's just, then it just becomes something an emergency.
It's about a $10,000 piece of equipment once it's installed.
Right, I was noticing that. Yeah. I'm not sure. I don't know what the requirements are for something to fall in as a capital expenditure, but sounds like that's a possibility. One should be on the list.
You may not have the answer right away, but so when we're looking at the $27,000 for the immediate facilities needs, so that this would come out of this year's budget?
Yeah, we don't have
to. I was going to ask, what would be the comparable number? What were we playing with last year? And then how does this compare to that?
We've got the same number this year as we had last year.
I can't remember what that was.
Let's go to the tape.
That's exactly why I presented this list and totaled it, because what it shows you is these small mid-range projects add up really quickly.
Oh, yeah.
Yep. You put a few of these projects on a sheet and you end up with a very big number.
We have 18,000 for the entire year.
Okay.
And currently we have about 13,000 left.
All right. I'm guessing some of these, some might fit under for the capital expenditure and others aren't. So pressure washing siding, it probably needs to be a budget item, not come out of a capital expenditure type of account. But I'm guessing, I don't know where the town would fall on that. But
so I'm looking to see if they have a definition in their memo. So. And they don't.
Okay.
Most of these in and of themselves probably don't fall into a capital account, but they also don't fit in the operating budget.
Right. Yeah. Well, we can show them. We can present them this, I think, as well as maybe...
it also says the budget hearings are going to begin in January.
Okay.
So...
Yeah.
Again, we're probably going to get called before we present, which is going to be difficult.
Yeah. When does the state release there?
Not to the end, the middle to the end of January.
Right. So, to a certain degree, how can we?
It's difficult.
I think they start collecting information from departments in terms of where.
And it's saying that they must be level services.
There's a shocker.
it might be a good time to start a discussion about having, rather than if funding these individual projects, having the town put a chunk of money aside every year for things like this. Mm-hmm. And if that money was there and accumulated over a couple of years, we could come to them and talk to them about how they spend the money they have, as opposed to how are we going to find any money to do this.
I think the other thing to remember is, depending on what it is, there could be MSBA money to match, but that would require a town. Just like we did the accelerator repair project in Deerfield to put their roof on.
So when we get to the point where we're going to replace the heating system, that's definitely something we'd want to go to MSBA with to say, hey, we need to do this. Can you match us?
Yeah.
And I would think of the four towns that Sunderland would have the highest reimbursement rate.
What do they call the account? It's escaped me what they call it. They have an account in common.
Stabilization.
Stabilization.
Well, so again, I mean, we could show them the list that's got the numbers. Also, mention the library AC, or again, I mean, they might say none of this is going to, they would spend out of the capital account, they just want to see it, even though it's not a normal budgetary, like, you know, it's not a recurring budgetary item, you know, we still need to find a spot for it in the regular budget. I'm not sure.
I didn't come today expecting to come back with a lot of money. What I came is knowing that I was going to provoke a lot of discussion. And I think that's a good thing. If we start to talk and the town starts to hear that there are some needs in the school that they need to find a way to fund,
yeah,
that's important.
We appreciate it, and I know the select board does too. I know they want exactly this kind of like thinking ahead. So it's good, yeah. Thank you.
Thanks, Bob.
Thank you.
So maybe what we can do is just delay our requests. Just so Sherry, I'll let the town administrator know we're talking about it, and maybe the conversation would be, you know, I know that the town has reached out to a consultant at the FERCOG, the Franklin County, because he's been in contact with Dr. Carey and I about the long range plan for the school, because the town of Sunderland is doing a long range capital planning project with them. So maybe when we meet with the select board, we can, you know, just say we have some interest in doing some capital, or at least setting up a capital, like a stabilization fund, so that we can start putting some money. And I'll also call Susan Marin, our treasurer, and see if we already have that.
Yep.
And how we access that if we do.
Okay. Yeah, and I think, I mean, this is public now, so I think this is something we voted as, this is, you know, I think helpful information for them to get an idea of what things we're looking at, and if there's anything they want to talk with you about more or us about more, they know where to find all of this, so, and then we can vote something as needed as we go along. Discussion or concerns about that? Sound good?
Good. All right.
Thank you so much.
All right. Well, thank you
for
the time
for presenting and doing the work for it.
Have a nice time.
All right. Next is under new business discussion items is the school lunch cost increase. Looking to, sounds like, have a vote.
So did you get the last month when I was here? Did you get these sheets to show you the situation that we're in, that we're upside down? What happens is we get money from the federal government for children in the free and reduced program. And if you look at the third block of numbers under free lunch where I have highlighted, this year they're giving us $2.78. So if you look up to the first one, the paid lunch, we're only charging $2.75. Can't do that. We can't charge less than the federal government is giving us, unfortunately. So the proposal would be to raise it 10 cents, because that'll probably buy us 2 years, but with no increases. So we would be voting to go up to $2.85 as of January 1st.
And what they give us is based on...
Oh, that's a question?
All
right.
Yes.
Said I was still on the blank.
So they're reimbursing us more than we're charging, but...
Correct.
But how is...
To tell you honestly, Doug, I'm sure that there is a large formula to figure out how much they're going to give us, but I don't know what it encompasses.
Okay.
I can find that out. I can do some research as to how they come up with their price.
Um,
January 1st.
So, in terms of the time, like sensitivity slash pressure for doing it, is there, I guess, what's the, what are the...
if my understanding, and correct me if I'm wrong, Patty, my, if we don't raise the cost now, we will be paying the 3%.
3 cents.
The 3 cents ourselves on every lunch sold until we do raise the cost. We have to, and I don't know if that's retroactive. What date?
Back to September 1st.
So we're already paying 3 cents for every meal sold since September 1st.
Right, okay.
So they base it on the consumer price index for all urban consumers. That's what they use to adjust their annual inflation rate.
Okay.
And they use a producer price index for fluid milk products for their milk programs. The power of Google.
Patty, the top box is the paid lunch, middle one is reduced, bottom one is free.
Yes.
Can you explain to me what the numbers underneath, like the state reimbursed, federal reimbursed, federal?
So that's the different monies that we get. So if you look at the first one, we charge $2.75. The state gives us 6 cents. The federal gives us 29 cents. And then the additional, they give us another 6 cents because our menus meet the new free and happy nutrition kids. So we actually get $3.16 a meal is what we're earning.
Okay.
And it's the same thing. So the reduced price, the student pays 20 cents, the state again gives us 6 cents, 29 cents, the Fed gives us 6, and then the federal reduced lunch program gives us 238, so we make 299 on a reduced lunch.
Okay.
And then on a free lunch, there's nothing from the student, and then 6 cents, 29 cents, 6 cents, 278, so we get 319 for a free.
Okay. And so that number is going to keep going up. I mean, it's 265.
Yes, it was 265 and 15, 270 and 16, and 278. And I believe that we had raised the prices in 14 to 275. And it lasted us through 15 and 16.
So if we go to 285.
I'm hoping that'll get us through 19.
Right, because it just went up 8 cents, so it goes up another 8 cents. Might hit it after 1 year.
I can't, new administration, I can't predict the economy.
Come on.
But the historical economics of when a Republican is in office goes way up. Inflation goes up, not which would drive our reimbursement down.
I mean, it has been voted on. The only thing I'm considering is it easy?
Is it what?
Easier just to go to, $3 and the back go longer, but then I want
to... No, we don't want to price ourselves out of the market either.
Right, because I don't want to jump up too fast, so I think 285 seems like a...
Yeah. Wheatley's already voted this, Deerfield and Conway, all the other three towns have already voted this. Right. And we're not touching the high school. And the high school's at $3, so I wouldn't want to bring our elementaries to $3.
Okay.
And the reason I was asking about the timing was just wondering if there was, if there were other things around, with the lunch program in general, and then to kind of potentially, roll out all our thinking together in one thing, including, a price increase. But that was, mostly it. But I guess the but is that if there's going to be a significant budget impact for us potentially doing that because we're going to wind up having to pay the difference that we don't collect in the meantime.
Is there going to be, if we, I assume we have to vote this in, is there going to be communication to parents?
Absolutely.
Has it already been, or is...
Okay. Well, you've talked to, you, you,
speak about it in October, correct?
November, I brought it up.
Yeah.
Oh, what, what month? I don't even know.
Yeah, we should be sending out the January, we should be receiving the January menus shortly, and that's the time we can communicate with families and send that out. I'll
make this. So, any other thoughts about this discussion?
Make a motion?
Second.
So that's for, was 10 cents?
Yep.
Mm-hmm. 285.
Okay. Ben, anything that's out there that you know of that for us to consider with regard to this that you've been hearing or one way or the other?
No.
Okay. All right. Any other discussion of it? All in favor? Thank you.
Yes.
So next is bus driver training procedures.
So a few of our school committees asked us what is, you know, what are our drivers trained in? So I sat down with Mr. Gripko of Gripko LLC, who is our bus contractor. And since June of 2010, all bus drivers, new bus drivers, are required to receive 60 hours of instructional training in order to get their driver's license for a bus. And then every year to recertify, they need 8 additional hours of training. And our company, Gripko, has 2 certified trainers on staff that provide those 8 hours. In addition to those 8 hours, we as a district, and we usually host it here in Sunderland, meet with our drivers before the beginning of every school year, and we update them on bullying, our bullying policies. And also our nurse gives them some basic first aid, how to inject EpiPens, things like that. So then we do that for them. December 9th, that was a Friday, the Mass State Police met with all our drivers at Frontier Regional and gave them a presentation on school bus security, how to, you know, identify a threat, how to call in a threat, things like that, and it was very well received by our drivers.
I just had one question. Under the prohibited practices, it says not to talk with riders while driving. Is that really happening on the school bus? Like, I feel like that's unrealistic.
I'm not sure.
Well, you got a hard and fast rule.
I'm not sure. You can't chat. Conversations.
Yeah, you can't carry on a conversation. You can give directives.
Right.
But I don't think that they're turning around saying, so what are you doing in school today?
One of the things that we are working on at the central office through Louise Law, our curriculum person, I've asked her to find bus safety curriculum for the students, to help the students understand that they have a responsibility on the bus to be safe bus passengers, that they have a job too while they're on the bus. Unfortunately, sometimes students on the bus feel that it's, you know, there's no teacher, there's no adult, you know, it's free time, and they get excited and they don't have as many rules because the structure really isn't there. Consequently, you do see a little bit of activity on the bus that's not safe. What we need to do and what we're planning on doing is getting a bus curriculum, a bus safety curriculum, and giving it, you know, exposing it to all the children to train the children on their piece in behaving on the bus and why it's so important. Because their behavior can contribute to us, to to danger. It could be dangerous. Not that our students are that far out of control. However, it doesn't take much for a bus driver to lose that focus on the road. It's a tough job because they are driving and they're working. You know, they've got all those little lights in their hands. And most of the time, the kids are fine. But every once in a while, they act up. And in order to be disciplining them or to making sure that they're following the rules while they're driving, it's an added pressure. We really want to instill in the children the importance of behaving appropriately because it could be dangerous. It's a very serious thing, and they need to know that they have their responsibility in it too.
And at dismissal on a daily basis, I provide the bus drivers with bus change sheets, whether someone else is going to be riding the bus that day and going to someone else's house, or they're a walker that day. And it's at that time I'm able to communicate with the bus drivers if anything's been popping up, and they usually let me know. And then I can address it directly with a student or group of students and get parents involved if need be as well.
That is very proactive with the bus drivers. I've done a couple of things with the bus drivers and the students. They're proactive. So that is going to be our piece in taking on that.
All right, the 2016 through 2019 Union 38 Teachers Association Instructional Assistance Agreement.
So we have for your signature tonight a memorandum of agreement. When this contract was negotiated, there was a new stipend provided for our instructional assistants who work in specialized programs or with specialized students. And what happened was the word discretionary was used, and the Franklin County retirement will not allow pension to be withheld on something, a wage they consider discretionary. So we spoke to them and their attorney and said, no, the purpose isn't that the wages are discretionary. The purpose is that the decision of who receives them is up to the superintendent's discretion. And they said, well, that's nice that was your intent, but that's not how it's written. So we need to rewrite the language in order for these earnings to be counted towards our instructional assistants' pension allocation when they go to retire. So that's all we're doing tonight is signing this so that these earnings can be pension includable.
To make it a little easier to understand what she's talking about, Our instructional assistants who work in substantially separate programs where the students are 60% out of their general ed classroom. That would be like Horizons. Those students have specialized, their IAs are working with highly complex cases. Also, individual instructional assistants who are working with medically fragile students where they have a little bit a higher level of training or a deeper amount of care where it's out of the ordinary. So they would be putting in feeding tubes or, cleaning things that otherwise a regular IE in their position wouldn't do. So those people, because it's specialized, we give them an extra hour a day pay. They don't work an extra hour a day. It's just a differential to, I think we figured out it equals to, X amount an hour. But they get a little bit of extra money a day for doing what it is they do. And the way it was written in the contract, the CBA, was, the superintendent is solely at the superintendent's discretion. They will receive this hour a day pay. Well, between the union president and myself, we ironed it out. We came up with these are the ones that are going to get the extra hour a day pay. Unfortunately, interpreted by the Franklin County retirement, they said that wording is too fuzzy in the contract. So we're asking you to really define that it's this extra hour a day pay is you know, it counts for retirement, that it is not discretionary pay. It is actual pay for what they're doing. The discretion is, it's not, the money's not the discretion, it's the job, the discretion is what those two.
Which ones fall into that category?
I'm trying to say it, articulate it.
Yeah.
But yes, how they get that extra.
So that's that last sentence, determination by his administration as to which positions include these duties are finally not subject to.
So that's discretion, but it's not the money.
Okay.
So the money should be adding up to their retirement. It should be going into their retirement.
Okay.
Thank you for helping me, Doug.
Okay, and you need a vote on that, it looks like.
And then your signature.
And then, okay, all signatures or?
Just yours.
Oh, okay. All right.
To amend the instructional assistance MOU between Union 38 and Sunderland School Committee as recommended by council.
Anybody wanna?
So moved.
All right.
Thank you, Keith.
Second?
Second.
All right.
Keep going.
And then discussion, questions? Seems pretty straightforward. Okay, all in favor?
Great.
Yeah. Okay. We got bonus. Signature. Oops, sorry.
No, that's okay.
I will say, we don't do easy, but we don't get bonus.
All right, winding down, home stretch. So committee reports, any committee meetings since our last school committee meeting? All right, Principal B.
You're great.
My report?
You're up.
All right, and I have extra copies here that just got there. Our sixth grade classes have been collaborating throughout the fall semester with students from Escola Oswaldo Arana, which is a middle school located in Esteio City, Brazil, through a program called IBECA. This is something our students, our sixth grade students, do on an annual basis. IBECA is a web-based platform that provides students with the opportunity to connect with one another from different cultures and countries. The culminating project of the IBECA experience is a live class Skype session with the partner school, and they present their final projects. They get to meet their modern day pen pal buddies that they've been collaborating with throughout the past few months. And that was held last Wednesday, December 14th. There's a lot of work that goes into making the live class happen, and our technology department, led by Scott Paul, with help from Stuart Doonesbury, Maureen Belcha, and Keith Van Buren, were absolutely integral in helping to make this happen. Our sixth grade teachers, Ryan Copeland and Ellen Von Flayer, also put in a lot of work for the live event. Yesterday, excuse me, students in grades K through 6 attended the musical Elf Junior at Frontier. This free performance was offered by Jaduk Center for the Performing Arts, and actually Doug's daughter Eliza was one of the performers yesterday. The kids had an absolute blast, and the performance was for free. So thank you very much for Jaduk for reaching out to our school. Upcoming events, on December 22nd, we have a visit from the Digital Teen Panel. This is a group of students who's put together, high school students who come and talk to our sixth graders about safe practices on the internet. Friday we have a fifth grade writing celebration, then our annual Snowflake Skate is on January 1st. At the UMass Mullen Center practice rink. We have another Cafe Sun coming up for sixth grade in January. And on January 26th is our annual international night where we celebrate the diversity and the different cultures found here at Sunderland.
Mr. Bereshefsky, what time does your snowflake skate on January 1st?
I believe it's 5:30 to 7:30. Do you plan on dusting off your skates?
God.
It's an awesome event.
It's great.
I know.
I skate once a year at that event.
That's me too. Me too.
I know it's very well attended. That's why I wanted you to tell me.
And it's a good fundraiser for our sixth grade.
Exactly.
Questions? Comments?
My daughter did the sixth grade Iveca. It was a great experience for her. Most of the time. We have a hard time dragging her out of bed in the morning. She actually got up because they had to come in early for it.
Yes, they did have
so
to come in early.
She was up and ready to go, which was stunning.
It was good practice for seventh grade when she's going to have to get up earlier.
It speaks volumes, right? How good the program is.
Yeah.
Get them out of bed. Well,
the kids had to arrive at the school between 7:15 and 7:30, so it was a commitment from families as well.
My other daughter was raving about Elf Jr.
Good. So the McFarland household was very happy.
It was a good week.
Yeah. Awesome. All right. Thanks. All right. And our superintendent report.
I don't have much tonight, but I did want to add to Principal Barshevsky's report by just reiterating how wonderful today's celebration was. The music is awesome. It is incredible the way these young ones, fourth, fifth, sixth grade, have taken to the strings, the violin, and I don't know what
cello, the bass.
The bass. They did a beautiful job. And then the brass instruments came out, and they were wonderful. They were singing along. And the music teacher, they did a rendition of Moon River, which it's just like, it's my favorite song. I love hearing it. I love
did she know that?
Andy Williams. Well, I went and told her after. She said, yes, it's a beautiful song. And they also sang some really nice, really great picks, different. The music was different. The with the strings, they did a play, it was called Little Red Riding Hood. And so they would describe the movements and then they'd do it with the music. And then they would describe, you know, what happens. But the music would actually speak to, it just gave such a layer of background to the story and brought it more to life. So anyhow, I have to say that was wonderful. I was so impressed. And the talent of this school, but not only that, the three really excellent teachers doing three different things, but all teaching it through music. And I'm sure, you know, the art teacher is just as wonderful, and, you know, the librarian and all that. But how fortunate these students are to be able to have this variety of music and this caliber of teachers. I've worked in schools where you'd have a concert and they put on the boombox and the kids would sing along to that. And not here. I'll tell you, it was wonderful. A couple of students in fourth, fifth, and sixth grade were doing solos. Their voices, tremendous. So anyhow, I just want to tell, I really want the people to know that we are so fortunate here in Sunderland to have such talented instructors, and they're bringing out the best in our students. So.
And the arts in the elementary schools really help to bring the experience for the students full circle. I don't think we can't lose sight of how important having the specials, the strings, the music, the PE, and the art. Here in our schools. And it makes a big difference for the kids and their experience.
And not to be taken for granted, because we've had budget situations where we were making cuts and for a short period of time it was being funded through you know, fundraising and volunteer work which is not, you know, long run sustainable. So we got that back in the budget, but yeah.
I really hope that we can speak to that when it comes time, if we find ourselves in a situation where we need to defend our budget. I really hope we can speak to that, because this, it just makes this school stand out.
And I think people understand that and do support it. So hopefully we're not in a position where we're making those kind of devil's choices anytime again soon. So
it is hard. It's hard to say yes. It's great and wonderful, but you know, I understand all of that. I do understand it. I can understand both sides deeply. But it's like when you said, you know, your daughter not loving to get up in the morning, but she got up for this thing. And I think some kids get up because, you know,
right.
It's strings today, or it's, you know, band today, or whatever. So I enjoyed it. I thank you, Ben, too, for inviting me and this community.
I'm the least musically inclined person, so.
And I'm sitting there singing and clapping. However, the only other thing that's really big on my to-do list is the move. We're moving Friday. And the people in the office are done on Thursday. That is two more days, and we're just kind of counting them down. And so it's a little high tension, but Friday, the movers are coming, and everyone in the office has a day, you know, just take the day. And then Monday, of course, is a holiday. The movers are gonna come back on Monday and finish up, because we have to disassemble, put it in the truck, and then assemble in the new place, but
reassemble.
And but you can only imagine with the amount of papers and records and files, but we're doing it, and everyone is really pulling their weight, and it's a big thing. So we will be working right through the holiday break. But we'll be fully operational on January 3rd when the students come back. So we're excited about that.
Look forward to being able to visit you over at the
Yes.
Middle School High School.
I know, Will. We are all sneezing and coughing and just moving all this paper and things. It just has gotten up so much dust that if it was bad before, it's worse now. Sneezing and coughing and stuff. However, so that we're excited. We're excited and we're grateful to all the school, to Frontier School Committee, and for their support, and then all of the support from Indiana 38 schools and us making this move. So that's how I know. I hope everyone has a wonderful holiday time.
Thanks, yeah. Yeah, I'll join you in wishing everyone safe and enjoyable holidays and time with families and friends, and entertain a motion to adjourn.
I'll make a motion to adjourn.
All right. Okay. I'll second.
Thank you.
All in favor?
Thanks.